train stopped in a beautiful railroad station where little houses met little flowers and geraniums, and we didn't think it was a little window where you had a chance to look when everybody wants to look. Then they throwed open this door, and there was a screaming and hitting with whips, out, out, out. We all stumbled out of this big door from the train, and little children got lost from the parents, and there was a little trolley that came on, what is in coal mine, this little trolley that goes over, and there throwed in the old woman and children that got lost from the parents, they throwed it in there, and that went straight to the gaskamer.
The plan developed when the fell handler came into the camp, Itamar Choi, because he realized we don't have nothing to lose. And the revenge was such a big thing in our hearts that we would have, every one of us would have given his life to take revenge.
We had ideas, different ones. And when they came, and there was among them was one captain in the Russian army, Sasha Petrus. We told him what's going on here, so he wanted to run away this first day. So we told him this, that it's not so easy as you think. There's guards all over and mines around, things like that. So we told him we have plans on our own.
We were afraid that if everybody would know, a leak out. So just a few, about 20 people. But we decided, being we saw what happened with the Waltz commander and before, that if one escapes, the others pay the price, we have to give everybody a chance. And we didn't have to pack luggage, and we didn't have to buy tickets, you know? To get ready. So we said the last day, we'll tell everybody. And that's how it was.
We were told, when the time will come, you will be told. But in the meantime, nothing. Because you didn't know who was going to tell the Germans what's going on. So they had to be so careful amongst themselves how it was going to be done.
When the Russian POWs came to us, our plan was ready to go. They just came in handy, like, you know, a gift from God. They were all together 28 days in camp, the Russian Jews. It took us probably 10 days to understand each other and to talk to each other and to start trusting each other. And when we could explain them the plan, they and that's what we need.
The plan, they told them, as I say, you cannot run away just like that, has to be organized. And he organized a plan how to run away. It was planned for everybody.
He knew every corner, every inch in the camp. We knew every SS from inside out. We knew every Ukrainian. We knew when they sleep and when they eat and when they walk and when they lay. And we knew where they're going to be at this time. We had their schedule all. And we gave it to them. We knew how to cut the wire. Like, we knew how to cut the telephone wire. We knew everything.
Cut electricity and telephone, because every hour they were in contact with a garrison from Lublin, if everything is okay. So we had to do it less than an hour, because if they don't have communication an hour, they know that something happened. So we have to do it swiftly, and we have to do it with precision.
The plan was very simple. It was divided in two phases. The first phase, which should last from 4 to 5, was the killing of the Nazis, killing them quietly, without arousing any suspicion, with knives and axes. The second phase was that after killing, when we assemble for the roll call, we should explode and have an open revolt and use the guns which we did get from the killed Germans. How to kill the Germans? For now, from the perspective, I think it was very easy. You see, the Germans depend on the guards, on the towers, on the Ukrainian guards. They themselves were the staff. And the sorting place where we were sorting, there was always a German, Wolf was his name, who didn't supervise we shouldn't escape, but he did supervise we should walk. And so on and other places too. So, but they were obligated, like the guards and the towers, to stay on the spot. They could go for a cup of coffee, they could go away. So if he killed one Nazi supervising the sorting of the shoes, then another Nazi who passed by, he didn't see him, he wasn't allowed.
We usually walk till 5 o'clock in the evening. And that time is it already starts to get dark. It was in October. So there was the plan was, an hour before we stopped working, the uprising will begin.
After we eat, was the roll call. That time, this was a dangerous time, because on that point on the roll call, all the Germans must come assemble in the counters. So actually, from 4 to 5, we could kill them very careful.
Then we were told the night before, be prepared. And if we had a little bit of changing of clothes to put it all under so but it won't be suspected that we are a little bit bigger because we were going in it. The 14th of October was late autumn in Europe, in Poland. So we had, and I still had my coat. I looked after it. I didn't wear it. I used to have it under my head. That was almost like a pillow to sleep on it. And I had my coat that day, took it with me, even if it was not so cold, but I had it on. And I had a scarf, and I had it a little bag.
Next day, I was impatient, I was scared. I wasn't scared really to die, because I had time to get used to it. I was scared that I will suffer. We prisoners, we always said we will not go to the gas chamber. We rather want to be shot.
There was one in the office. Was a German, and he had to be killed. So there were two guys were appointed to do it. Now, one of them got scared. They said, I don't go.
This man had to go and kill this German. But at last minute, he got afraid. Said, I'm afraid, I don't want to go.
We have already so many killed. There's no way back. If we don't go through it, we're sure dead.
I said, you have to go to Anno. When there was a messenger boy who told us how many are dead.
I had to relay to the main command what, that this Gestapo is dead already. And the next one, every time they killed somebody, I ran into the command. Pichowski was there and I gave him the report. He killed one by one. One to the shoemaker, to the watchmaker, we killed him one, everything. They came to the appointment to meet that.
That there are 10 dead and you have to go. And he said, no, I can go. So Chaim went inside and took a knife, and he went instead.
And I went together with the other fellow, and went in, and we killed the German. And I jabbed him with the knife, and I said, this is for my father, for my brother, for all the Jews what you killed. And we killed him.
Then a Ukrainian biked into the camp. I think his name was Klad. And as soon as he was in the camp, a group of young kids surrounded him, threw him off the bike, and knifed him to death. I went out, dragged him between two barracks in a narrow spot so that the Ukrainian guard on a tower couldn't see him dead.
Anyway, by 5 o'clock, most of them were killed of the Nazis. They didn't know, it was quiet. At 5 o'clock, as usual, a prisoner went to the tower and put a signal out with a trumpet at the end of the walk. The couples assembled it like every day, because the rule was it should look like every day. And the two couples which were in the organization were ordered even to beat us by us every day. If somebody slaughtered, and we were assembled in groups, and we marched to the kitchen, to the main yard. It's 5 o'clock. And now I remember when I marched in, I was shocked to see how many people don't know what's happened. When we were six in that part of the camp, we were 500 in that time. If we were 500 people, I guarantee about 450 stand in the line for food, not knowing that practical 95% of Germans are killed. But now one told another one, in simple, and they were kissing each other.
Bauer, another Schauffeurer, came from the third camp with a truck, and something had to be unloaded. I'm not so sure what it was there, and they couldn't find somebody because it was nearly roll call and finish of work. And then he went into an office, and he saw blood on a door or something, and that German was lying under the desk, dead, and then went to the alarm. Started.
Sasha Pichowski he stepped up on the table and said, my brothers and sisters, the war is almost over. Let's get out of this place and tell the world what happened. If somebody will survive, it should tell the world what happened.
Some of the boys and the men were impatient. They wanted to climb over the barbed wire, and they got shot there. And then the boys started to cut the wire through so we could run. But most damage were done from the towers where the Ukraine got. The Germans had only rifles or pistols, but the machine guns were up top in the towers, and there were four towers.
Then they said everybody on the snow over that. And there was a stepladder, somebody put it up. And I jumped up the stepladder. And as I jumped up, I got a shot from a tower, from a Ukrainian.
Mine was starting to go up.
Started running. I wasn't far away from that opening they made in the fences. And on the way, there was somewhere a bush, because not only that, but from the camp to the forest, there was more than a kilometer clearing, and there was even some logs were lying there, and we had to jump over the logs and duck, you know, not the shooting, just to the opposite direction of the shooting.
We started to run all over, and with the step ladders on the barbed wire, and I went up on the barbed wire, and my finger was cut from the barbed wire, was bleeding.
And I ran along that row of buildings to that ladder. I jumped over. Leumich Neisner was behind me. He was the last one. I was the second last to escape in that spot. And I was walking fast through the meadow, and I landed in the forest.
I started hopping over the dead bodies, and I made it to the woods.
1% did we ever hope of surviving. We did it to take revenge and not to go to the gas chamber. And if we do get killed, some of them will come with us, of the Germans. And that's what we did.
You know, I have today the impression that the Germans were too complacent. Everything was running so smooth that they were too complacent to think even about being more cautious to prevent an escape.